This video is sponsored by Delete Me. As we know full and well here in California, our planet is facing a freshwater crisis, so the need for innovative solutions is greater than ever. There are dozens of different approaches to tackle this issue, but what if I told you there was a new way to get fresh water from the ocean that is so elegant in its simplicity and so obvious that it's a wonder why no one has thought of it before? And guess what? It's not desalination. It's a new twist on atmospheric water harvesting. And today we're going to talk about how it works and why it might be the next big thing. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Da Vinci. Today, almost 2 billion people worldwide, that's 26% of the global population, live without safely managed drinking water. And we're currently facing the worst mega drought in the last 1,200 years here in California. Now, yes, the recent rains here in 2023 have mitigated a lot of that, but this cycle will eventually continue in the future. Now, if you live anywhere on the Southwest coast, I know you felt this too, but you've probably also felt it if you live in some parts of Brazil, a country known for the Amazon, the world's largest tropical rainforest. Yet the earth is almost covered in water. So what is the problem? Well, there are two sides to this issue. The first is that most of the earth's water is in the oceans as salt water, which isn't drinkable. There is an estimated 1.38 billion square kilometers of water on earth. But only 2.5% of that is freshwater, and almost 71% of that freshwater is frozen in glaciers at the polar ice caps, leaving only 29.2%, some 10 cubic kilometers, of fresh liquid drinking water. However, over 99% of that liquid freshwater is locked in underground reservoirs inaccessible to us, leaving only 0.92% of liquid water in rivers and lakes for us to actually drink. This means we only have 0.0067% of the total water on Earth available for consumption, slightly less if you discount polluted waters. But even though this percentage is quite small, it still represents about 22,300 cubic miles or 93,000 cubic kilometers of fresh, liquid, easily accessible drinking water, or roughly 25 quadrillion gallons. That's a lot of water. To put this in perspective, the average person consumes a little over 79 gallons of water per day at home. So the entire world population consumes around 228 trillion gallons of water per year. So in total, in a whole year, we use less than 1% of the total available water supply at any given moment. And remember, this is a renewable source that replenishes itself through the water cycle. So there's plenty of water to go around, even after accounting for population growth, which brings me to the second issue, population distribution. You see, the problem isn't that there isn't enough fresh water on Earth. The problem is that water isn't always where it needs to be because of the way the population is distributed on Earth. A good 2.3 billion people, almost 30% of the population, lives in water-stressed countries, according to the UN. We even see the same distribution problem within countries. I mean, look at the US. Places like California and Arizona house millions of people, yet they're among the driest states in the country. Water management and recycling in places like Las Vegas have proven to be successful in cutting down water usage, but this strategy is inherently limited by how much water is available to begin with, and isn't sustainable in the long term as the population grows. Take Las Vegas as an example. The general manager of the Southern Nevada Water Authority, John Ensminger, was once quoted saying that this neon city is one of the most water-efficient cities in the world, and that the city beat the odds by cutting its overall water use by 26% while also adding 750,000 people to its population since 2002, which is commendable. But it's obvious that it hasn't been enough, since about 10% of Las Vegas water comes from groundwater aquifers, and most of them are running dry. But before we get into that, let me tell you about a sponsor this week, Delete Me. Delete Me is a hands-free subscription service that'll remove your personal information that's being sold online. Delete Me's privacy experts remove your information from Google and 100-plus data brokers all year long. Get a privacy report in 7 days. It'll remove your personal information like phone and address. It'll even monitor sites and repeat removal as needed, and users can even make custom removal requests. I've been a customer for over a month, and I've recently received my first quarterly report. Check out all the different places where Delete Me has removed my data, my name, and in some cases, my address and other information. In some cases, your data is removed right away, but other times, data brokers take up to 6 weeks, but Delete Me keeps track of it all and takes care of everything automatically. So stay a step ahead of your privacy online, get that extra peace of mind of having a privacy advocate on your side, and save 20% on all plans with code Ricky with Delete Me. links in the description. Huge thanks to Delete Me and you for supporting the show. So besides water management, we must find additional sources of water. Israel is probably the world's best example of pulling this off. By combining smart water management and education with desalination, they've turned a water-stressed nation into a water surplus exporter in less than 20 years. So the question is, why aren't desalination plants everywhere? This is exactly what I asked myself about 10 months ago when I made this video that I strongly recommend you watch after this one. Links in the description. In short, the problem is desalination is very expensive and it produces a concentrated saltwater solution called brine that is usually pumped back into the ocean where it can wreak havoc by altering local salinity and temperature on the ocean floor. This raises several important questions like, why aren't salt companies or lithium mining companies partnering with desal companies to extract valuable minerals from the brine? Why is the brine treated as waste and not a resource? I did a bit of research and the answer is, as always, cost. Although it is possible to extract valuable minerals and compounds like sodium hydroxide and hydrogen chloride, which are widely used in hundreds of industries, not to mention in most toilet cleaners and in nearly all caustic drain cleaners and oven degreasers, it's more expensive than traditional production methods. As long as there are cheaper alternatives out there, there will be little demand for brine byproducts. That said, researchers from MIT have been working on an economically viable product mix to make brine a good and competitive source of certain industrial chemicals, so fingers crossed. We still have a big challenge to face. If there's not enough surface water, not enough rain, and we're draining all of our underwater aquifers dry, where do we get fresh water for the millions of people that live on coastal cities without desalinating the ocean? The answer, as it turns out, is all around us. We condense it out of thin air. This is called atmospheric water harvesting, or generation, AWG for short. Now, a small disclaimer, I already made a video about this a while ago where I explain a couple of details in certain technologies and how companies like Tsunami Works can help you disconnect from the water utility grid with their water condensers, the bigger units being able to pump out roughly 330 gallons of fresh drinking water per day. That's enough for a family of four. I'm hoping we can get our hands on one of these, and if we do, we'll definitely make a video about it. But we're talking about an investment of $50,000 for the bigger unit that will last around 20 years producing 330 gallons of water per day, and that's just a lot of money. Furthermore, considering that the average U.S. household pays little under $50 a month on their water bill, although it's closer to $100 here in California, this means it would take roughly 40 to 80 years for the investment to break even. And that's without counting the insane amount of electricity these things consume, which is close to 11 kilowatts. But if you're thinking, sure, but a dependable and clean water supply is priceless. To that, I would say you're right, but there is some bad news because some of these units might not generate the stated 330 gallons of water per day, depending on humidity levels and the exact climate where you live. This is because this system works by cooling and compressing the air until it reaches its dew point, basically the point at which the air becomes saturated with water vapor and is forced to condense out. But it only works efficiently if you have really humid air. The problem is relative humidity, which is how much water vapor is in the air and compared to how much it can hold. It's the same principle as a sponge. If the sponge is wet, as in containing a lot of the water that it can hold, you'll have no trouble wringing water out of it. But if the sponge is just lightly damp, like in low relative humidity, you can squish it all you want, but very few drops of water will actually come out. So essentially, the success of an atmospheric water harvesting system is tied to how humid the air is, and we can't exactly control that. Or can we? A team of researchers from the University of Illinois Urbana-Champaign, led by Dr. Praveen Kumar, Afifa Rahman, and Francino Dominguez, just had the most amazing idea of how to work around all the inherent challenges of atmospheric water harvesting by using the ocean. Dr. Kumar and his team's idea to capture and condense humidity not from the dry air you'll find inland, but rather from the very humid air directly above the ocean's surface. You see, water will naturally evaporate from and condense on the surface of any body of water, and if it's big enough, it'll come close to reaching an equilibrium where air contains nearly as much water vapor as it can hold at any given temperature. This basically means that the air directly above the ocean surface has almost 100% relative humidity, which is basically why your sweat evaporates more slowly when you're at the beach. This makes this ocean vapor ideal for atmospheric water harvesting. Their design uses a large tower as an air collector to capture humid air from the ocean's surface and pump it to a ground-based condenser that uses energy to turn vapor into liquid water, and then pump the condensed fresh water, which will already be drinkable, to your house. With this simple but powerful idea in mind, the team of researchers set out to find out exactly how much potential there was behind harvesting oceanic water vapor. Where would the best places to put it be, and how much water could they really harvest? They proposed building an offshore collector tower, 110 meters tall and 200 meters wide. They wanted to make it really high to take advantage of higher horizontal wind speeds at greater heights, which increases the flux of moisture through the tower. To find out exactly how much vapor this surface could capture, they ran very detailed computer simulations using hourly atmospheric climate data like temperature, pressure, humidity, and wind speed over the oceans of the world, focusing on 14 key coastal locations near large water-stressed populations like Los Angeles, Barcelona, Tripoli, Mecca, and Perth, among others. So I'd love to geek out about all the calculations these guys have done to figure out exactly how much water they could produce, because that's the kind of calculations I love doing when I make these videos. But the reality is that'll get a little bit too complicated, so I'll just break down some of the key takeaways below. Here's what they found. Across all 14 sites around the world and averaging the last 30 years of historical data, each 1 meter wide, 200 meter tall vertical strip of ocean vapor tower surface has the potential to capture between 0.6 and 1.45 million liters of water per day. So the proposed 200 meter wide structure would be able to scoop up 120 to 290 million liters of water per day, which is about 32 to 76 million gallons per day. That's enough water for 400,000 to 900,000 people. So to put that into perspective, the LA Aqueduct, one of the biggest in the world, receives around 524 million gallons of fresh water per day. So 10 of these units could single-handedly cover LA's entire water demand and most likely have a surplus. This table shows the numbers for the other locations along with the number of units we'd need to cover the entire city's demand. Italy had the lowest potential in the Tyrrhenian Sea near Rome, with only 0.3 million liters per meter of tower per day, but even there it would only require 9 towers to cover demand. One of the key findings was that unlike water sources in arid places that tend to dry up even more during rising temperatures, these higher temperatures actually increase yield in the ocean water vapor towers, since it increases the evaporation rate. So this is a great long-term solution that'll work even better if scientists' worst-case scenarios are ultimately realized. So one thing I thought about when deploying structures like this is what the impact would be on the environment. Will these 200-meter collectors disrupt the normal water cycle by tapping the water at the source? Will they impact local or global weather patterns? And what about sea life and other considerations? Well, the team thought of this too, because based on their calculations and predictions, this wouldn't really have too much of an impact. In fact, if we built collectors across all 14 studied locations, they would extract 780 billion liters of water annually, but that would only amount to 0.0015% of the total amount of water that evaporates off the ocean each year. The next thing on your mind is probably cost. How much will the system cost to install, maintain, and run? How long will they last once the infrastructure is in place? Thankfully, Kumar and his team thought of this and did some financial feasibility studies as well. They assumed a cost of $500 million to build a water infrastructure that'll serve 500,000 users and $100 million for a renewable power plant with solar and wind. The system should last roughly 30 years for an annual cost per beneficiary of $67. So what this means is that the entire construction project will only cost you as an end user $67 per year or about $5 per month. Operation and maintenance costs for the lifetime of this project will contribute 78.3% of the total cost and will run you another $174 annually. So the total cost to your annual water bill will be in the amount of around $241 per year or $20 per month. That's less than half the national average and a quarter of the California average. After 30 years, you'll have saved a minimum of around $11,000 and a maximum of almost $30,000. So to summarize, this is cheaper than conventional water, much cheaper than desalination on its best day. It doesn't hurt the environment in any meaningful way, and if you power it with solar and wind, it would be totally renewable. It's scalable without putting extra stress on our traditional water supplies. Of course, there are still a ton of questions regarding how exactly the tower will suck up and pump the air. Why do they draw the air ducts over water? Why don't we pipe them to shore underwater? The cold water could condense the vapor inside the pipe, allowing for us to forego the entire condensation unit. What condensation system is best suited for it? what efficiency are we looking at, and how much of the vapor will actually be able to condense out of the air? Despite the many questions, the moment I read about this, which is published in Nature's magazine Scientific Report just 2 months ago, I immediately knew these guys were onto something. This is exactly the type of idea that really gets me excited about the future. This is just a theoretical paper, and all the technical details still have to be ironed out before it's actually implemented. As far as how long this might actually take to reach final production, there's no reason to think that it'll take all that long. The technology is nothing new. In fact, it's just a clever reimagining of air-water generation systems that are already being built today by companies like Tsunami Works. But by building them out on the ocean, we can take advantage of the fact that there is a layer of very humid air right over our oceans, and that is a resource that is continually being replenished as the sun comes up every day. This is one of those ideas that I love, and I think it could really be a slam dunk. So if you're an ambitious or clever inventor or entrepreneur or engineer, maybe this is one of those projects that you might want to pick up on. Because yes, today we do have water, and water is still relatively cheap. That's what makes funding these kinds of projects difficult. But there will come a day when the water will slowly dry up more and more, and the prices for water will go up. We've seen this happen with natural gas. Natural gas, in America at least, was seen as such a cheap commodity that most homes use it for cooking, for heating, for clothes drying, all sorts of applications. But as the war in Ukraine and other global considerations have changed that dynamic and raised natural gas prices, we're rethinking that. And that same thing will happen with water. Yes, it's not too late right now, but the best thing we can do is invest before it is too late. Build these now, and then when the water prices go up and the water aquifers start drying out, we could turn these systems on. It's best not to wait till it is too late to invest in this. And that's why we need some cleverness and some people with vision who can see into the future and build these systems before we absolutely have to. And I think there's going to be a huge opportunity for that. All right, that is a look at this video. If you like water topics, I think you'll like this video as well that we've made. So check it out. Now, until next week, I'm Ricky, and this is Tuba Da Vinci.